Nu ska vi gå vidare i världen här och nu ska vi över till Genève och FNs arbete med textiler och hållbarhet. Och de har nämligen kartlagt hela värdekedjan. So switching to English again. Global stocktaking, sustainability and circularity in the textile value chain. And we welcome Bettina Heller, who is a program officer at UNDP.
So thanks again. I will talk a bit about research we have done on the topic of sustainability and circularity in the textile value chain. It's actually a report that we are going to release this month, and it builds on research that we've done with the support of an institution in India called FICCI. But I also just want to stress up front that we build a lot on multi-stakeholder consultations. I know that also some of the people listening and participating in the meeting today were also very helpful and involved in getting the report to where it is now. So thank you to everybody who provided comments and gave their inputs on this. I also wanted to clarify before I go into the details that in the report we talk about the textile value chain, and if we look at what textiles are, we actually have the classification into industrial technical, apparel, and household textiles. And the research part of our report focuses on a life cycle assessment of apparel. So actually we have not researched for the environmental impacts and the socioeconomic impacts, industrial, technical, household textiles. But we think that since apparel makes up 60% of the global demand for fiber and the fiber mix is very similar to household textiles, it's fairly indicative for the textile value chain as a whole. Now, looking at the textile value chain, for us it's quite important to always take this approach, because if we look at where are the impacts along the value chain, which stages produce which sort of impacts, and which opportunities lie around which stages, that will also help us to avoid unintended trade-offs or burden shifting, to take the measures that are the most impactful, and not only small measures that will only impact one stage but might worsen impacts in another stage, for instance. So the textile value chain as we know it at the moment, you can see on screen here, it's fairly linear. And I think our aspiration, and that's of course something you're discussing today in the meeting, is to move towards a more circular system. A system where we can try to reduce the inputs by design, where we can try to reuse products as long as possible, to refurbish them, remanufacture them, and at the end of life, of course, also to recycle them. If we look at the geographical breakdown of the global apparel production, maybe what's interesting to note is that with the rising value of a product, the global share diversifies geographically. So a lot of the more lower value add stages occur in the producing countries in Asia, and a lot of the more higher value add stages occur in Europe and North America, which of course also already points to some of the socioeconomic issues that exist along the textile value chain. In terms of environmental hotspots, so I don't want to dive into too much detail because we only have 10 minutes, so I see this more as a teaser, and then I hope you're all gonna read our report. But we have looked into climate impacts, into land impacts, water impacts, and impacts on ecosystems, which is a lot connected, of course, to the chemicals that are being used. And I just wanted to give you an overview of the sort of hotspots, so the key environmental impacts that we have identified in the research. And those are, for instance, in terms of cotton cultivation, there are a lot of use of chemicals. It uses a lot of land and water. But then when we talk about synthetic fibers, there's a lot of fossil fuel use in the production. I think this is quite an interesting point also to make, that it's not necessarily let's switch from fiber A to fiber B and that's the solution, but we also have to see what are the impacts of each fiber, and each has its up and downsides, and it's more about changing the entire system and the business models. When we look more at the consumption side, there are also high impacts in terms of the electricity we use for washing and drying, though that, of course, depends a lot on the context of the country we're in, what's the energy mix of the country, and so on. And for end of life, it's important to consider the value loss that occurs because textiles aren't used for the long time that they could be used. As I said, I'm not going to go into detail, but I just wanted to show you for one of the impact areas how we structure the information in our research. So if we look at climate impacts, we know that they are quite high, and there are always these numbers being cited that fashion after the shipping and transport industry is the second highest impact on climate. What we try to do here again is to look at which value chain stages have which sort of impact. So here we can, for instance, see that the highest impact for climate occurs on the bleaching, dyeing, and finishing phases, which is due to the heating of water and that the energy for this usually comes more from coal-based energy in the countries, and then again the use phase. And so the kind of actions and recommendations that we can get from this is that, for instance, here we would need to look into really extending the useful life of clothes, because once we don't use the clothes for a long time, then all the impacts that went into, for instance, the textile production phase, they also get lost because there's inherent value that will get lost. We are also looking into socioeconomic impacts in the report in terms of the human health damage, the value loss at end of life, and the social risks. Maybe for social risks, again, to say that our findings show that they are the highest in the early stages of the value chain, which is maybe even made a bit more serious by the fact that these early stages often occur in countries where the social protection net isn't the strongest. So there's definitely a lot of room for action here. Here is a summary in terms of the hotspots that we've identified, again, just to show you sort of how this could be presented. We would again look at the key impacts for a certain value chain stage. So you see that a lot of it is actually due to fossil fuel use and electricity use, which then of course impacts the climate. But we also have the usage of land and water and agrochemicals. And almost throughout we have social issues concerning unsafe working conditions and the fragility of the legal system. We also looked a bit into the COVID-19 impacts, of course, along the textile value chain, which has been so much in the news now and is really a topic that we have to consider further also going forward for how some of the issues that emerged can be tackled. What we found is that most of it was more, it further worsened the existing fragilities of the system. And here you can see a few examples. There are much more impacts that occurred, but it's just a few things that we wanted to highlight. So, for instance, it really showed that because there was delays in terms of trade, in terms of raw materials being passed from one country to the next, that really affected the production in some countries, which of course then affected the workers. There were a lot of social issues in terms of the lack of social security and workers using their jobs and their livelihoods and really being endangered. At end of life, there was also an issue because the textile waste management reached its limit. Of course, then there is a lot of waste being produced because of protective equipment, but also cancelled orders and overproduction of orders that then weren't sold anymore. We finish our research by then looking at which initiatives already tackle certain of these value chain stages and hotspots that we found. And from that, we have defined three key needs and priority actions, which is also something that came out very strong out of stakeholder consultations. So it'd be interesting to see also if this is something that comes out of the meeting today. But what we've heard and what we found is that we really need to do more around the changes in consumption habits. And I know that Sweden is already doing quite a lot actually on this front in terms of also consumer engagement and campaigns. So we definitely need to tackle this stronger if we want to change the system. There's more support needed in terms of collaboration and finance, especially if we think about innovations and new business models. If we think about changing this fast fashion industry and producing products that can be used for a longer time, that build up on repair and reuse, then there also need to be finance mechanisms that can support this sort of business model. And finally, what we've heard a lot is there's a need for stronger governance and policy support to really provide an enabling framework for the businesses to make those changes. And to finish, just to let you know that so this report will publish in October, but we want to develop a roadmap that will dig a bit deeper into these actions and really look at what each stakeholder at a global level can do to make the textile value chain more sustainable and more circular. And if any of you are interested to be involved in this work, then please just reach out to me. And we will also, with the support of the European Commission, we have just kickstarted a new project that will assess economic models' potential. So looking at what, in terms of impacts, does it actually need to move the textile value chain to a more sustainable system. And finally, sorry, then I'm gone. Under the same project, we're also supporting governments and SMEs in Africa, and we're soon going to launch a call for proposals. So if you want to learn more on this, please visit our website. And we are also convening an expert community that the government of Sweden is also part of. And if you want to learn more about this and the work of our partners, which is excellent, then please also just visit the website. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, Bettina.